taken some things. So here is the time that I warned you, forewarned you about, our interactive piece. So really want to look out and see what questions that you all might have after listening to our team.
I do want to tell you I remarried.
I challenge everyone in this room to not use the word guy when you're in a room full of women. It makes no sense. Robin was talking about when she was going into work that it was teacher, nurse, secretary. So does everyone here realize that up until the 1960s, you actually opened the paper and it said women's health wanted on one side and men's on the other? And under women's health wanted, your job options were nurse, secretary, bookkeeper, teacher. That was it. So, I mean, it wasn't like you could even apply for a job in any other area because the requirement was you had your own page of jobs and that was what was offered. So, yeah. All right. I can take questions.
Yeah. Perfect.
Little history lesson.
What questions do y'all have?
Come on, I challenge you. It won't embarrass us. We'll give you the full statement.
Initiative that my company just went through. A little bit of history. So employee turnover was definitely a challenge for me because I employ nurses. And nurses can leave on Monday a job with no notice and no references and walk in Tuesday to any hospital or any company in town and start the next day. It doesn't matter if I give them a reference or they've given me notice. That RN degree is amazing. And in fact, I just read where by the year 2025, Arizona alone is going to be short 10,000 RNs. So that's a challenge for me. You know, I can't pay enough. Somebody would come back and say, they offered me $100 more. And I always said, well, you should take it because I can't play that. I'll give you $101. So retention, employee retention has always been a big deal for me. So culture is what I focused on rather than the dollar. Nurses make a lot of money out here in Arizona in workers' comp case management. They start on a base of $70,000 to $80,000 a year with no experience. And with bonuses can make, I've got a nurse, $150,000, $160,000, $170,000. But while they're ramping up, that's really expensive for a business owner to kind of eat that salary while you wait till they get busy. So nurse turnover has caused more than a headache many, many years for me. I'd have a good year, then a turnover year, then a couple good years, and a turnover year. So just recently, in fact, in the spring, we partnered with a company that does those predictive index testing. And we have placed perfect people for the perfect job. Are you guys familiar with those predictive index testing companies?
Which one do you use?
We use MindWire. What is called MindWire? I think there's Colby here in town. What did you say?
Briggs Myers.
It's called MindWire, the one that we use. And we take this 6-minute test, and somehow after 6 minutes, it tells you exactly who you are, and it nails it. I took it myself. It nails it. And so we built a profile. We had our best nurses take this test. We built a profile and said, this is what you need. It gives you a red, yellow, and a green. Prior to that, I do want to talk a little bit, if you'll indulge me, in something that we created the company to help retention. Like a lot of you, I made the mistake the first few years of business of spending a lot of money on employee retention that didn't work, such as taking my staff on cruises. Any of you guys ever do anything like that? Anything dumb like that? I spent 7 years taking, at the time, anywhere between 20 and 40 employees and their spouses on that little Ensenada cruise out of Mexico. It's cheap as heck, but I flew them over there. This cruise, I think it's $329 for a cruise, $329. It's a blast, but at the end of the day, it was $50,000 I could have put in my pocket for 7 years, right? Didn't engender any loyalty. 1 year I took the staff on a cruise and I had an entire branch in Salt Lake walk the next Monday. No notice. I was like, used to sit with me at dinner. So at that time, that was 2011, I thought to myself, these cruises don't work for loyalty, I'm done. And I created something called a partnership profit plan. I just made this up. And what I did was I made a pool of about $50,000 every year, between 40 and 50 every year, And the people who've been with me 5 years or longer get to sit in this board. We have quarterly meetings. They get advanced information, company information for the other employees. And then quarterly, we divide up profit checks. And if you've been with me full-time 10 years, you take home the same cut that the owner takes. And they love that. We schedule meetings around our company meetings, so we kind of have we developed like this cool kids club, where the tenured people get to go off into a separate room because it's by invitation only. You have to have been with us for 5 years to go. And I'm telling you, it works. It works. People who've been there 4 years really want to hang in there and go, I want to be part of that board. So that between that board that we created and then partnering with the Predictive Index people really worked for me.
And if I can add, vision and mission statement is so important to your company, because if they don't get on board when you're interviewing and they don't have the same like values, the chances are of them staying for a long time is nil to nothing. I have to say, 2 years ago, I purged my entire sales force. I'm in 24 states in Ontario, Canada. So it's very difficult to have people when you're not in the office have that feeling. I came back, I hired vice presidents and a president of the company that, by the way, I just put out to pasture. He couldn't handle it. He's a sales guy now on the West Coast. I'm looking for the right female president that I think I can work with. But the important part, the important thing for you to understand is the culture of your organization. If you don't have a mission statement and a vision, how does your team know where you're going? So it's really, really important, no matter how big you are or how small you are, that vision statement, that vision and mission statement are critical.
Fantastic, thank you. Thank you both. Who else? I saw some other hands. Here, Kelsey.
I'm curious your opinions on maternity leave, given you're all mothers and business owners.
I'm curious your opinions on maternity leave, given they're both mothers. And Tammy, you touched on it a little bit. Mothers and business owners, because I'm also a product of an all-girls school, but also a product of a business owner father. So I feel that's an interesting balance there.
My company gives maternity and paternity leave. We give a month of pay, and we, because I'm not that big, we ask them to save their 2 weeks vacation if they want 6 weeks. However, we have flexible work environment, so the vast majority of my jobs are home-based, and that's the best I can do.
I have to say, it's written in our employee handbook, but for some unknown reason, I haven't had a maternity case. I've got women, but they're either too old or too young. There's been nobody in the childbearing years yet that have needed it.
We live in a country in which man is the model and women are sort of guests in it. So the expectation is that a worker is not going to take time off of work, and if you do, you're kind of costing the business money, right? That was sort of the expectation is that women are the ones who will step aside, and so that's how people rationalize paying women less and then not letting us back in. Of course, I 100%, I don't have any employees, so I don't have to worry about this. But yes, of course, we need to have provisions for maternity leave, or else men and women are never going to be able for parental leave, mm-hmm. or else women and men will never be able to compete on an actual level playing field. Because again, if the expectation is that women are just costing a company money or that they're just going to drop out to have kids, that's just ridiculous. We are the only developed country in the entire world that doesn't have a mandate for some sort of maternity or parental leave. For some reason in the United States, we've got this idea that women will just do it for free and, you know, stop complaining about it. So, unacceptable, and don't get me started.
I want to add as well, I have two children with my previous husband. They're both adopted. And at the time in the 80s, you weren't allowed any time off. I had to ask for medical leave to go to court to conclude the adoptions. So I think we've come a long way. We need to come a long way more. In my handbook, it's all covered. A man gets paternity leave, a woman gets maternity leave, you can have time off for the adoption. My people have been with me the shortest, 2 years, the longest, 17. So if you can keep people like that, that's what builds your organization and what keeps you relevant. You have to be relevant in today's world or they're not paying attention to you.
But you're at the whim of the employer, because again, there's no, as a country, we haven't made this a priority. So maybe you're gonna work for somebody who cares about it, maybe you aren't, oh well. That's not acceptable. What's your feeling on that?
I go back and forth because, like I said, I went to an all-girls school. I'm definitely a feminist at heart, but then I've seen the business owner side of it and how costly it is when a female takes 3 months off and how difficult that is for the organization. So that's why I was curious. I mean, yeah, very curious.
Can I share? We don't have maternity leave, but we certainly have people who've taken vacations or long extended,
yeah,
for one reason or another, maybe health. It only causes an inconvenience. It can be costly, but it only causes an inconvenience if you're not prepared. Mm-hmm. Everyone in my office can do everybody's job. We've cross-trained across the board, from inputting data to making name badges, which we do in-house, to interviewing people. When you can cross-train in your business, you don't feel that so strongly, because everybody lifts up and tries to take over so that one person's not missed. Now, is it easier when they're there? Absolutely. But we're not really down and out. How many of you own your own agency in here? How many of you provide health insurance for your employees? Good for you. I went to work for this company that was a good old boy company for the first 30 years. I got $125 a month to spend any way I wanted as my health insurance. How many of you know that $125 won't even wipe my rear end, okay? So the first thing I did when I bought the company, even though I was crunching for money, it was a cash flow issue, is I provided insurance for my people. I paid 90%. I make sure that they have to put a little in so that they really appreciate what they get. But I paid 90% of their insurance for 17 years. I think that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, I think that's 11. I've owned it for 11.
What other questions?
Yeah, I have a question for you. And Kimberly, you kind of started it. You said that we shouldn't feel alone, you know, that we're not alone. I was curious, as each of you have probably had those experiences where it felt pretty lonely. What can we do to support each other better? Like, what are examples where women supported you and it really made a difference for you? What does that look like?
I joined NABO, as I said, National Association of Women Business Owners. It's a national organization, so it's almost everywhere. It's probably local in your town and you don't know about it. It's where Robin and I met. It's where we got our feet wet and how we learned to connect with other women. However, I outgrew it, and you can do that. As a CEO and a solopreneur, I didn't have anybody I could talk to. I couldn't talk down to my employees because that's the wrong thing to do. So I started looking for other organizations. I needed to network myself. I own the oldest networking organization in North America. It's a professional organization, but I couldn't talk to my own people. So I went to Vistage, which is a CEO organization that can really help you. I also belong to Women's Presidents Organization. They're both international, and I get to meet women from other countries. We're going into 8 other countries in the next 2 years. So it's made great connections for me, and it's surrounded me with women that are CEOs just like I am, as well as men. So WPO, Women Presidents Organization, are just women. Vistage is men and women. So while men are a pain in the neck once in a while, they do have ideas that have worked for them well for years. They know how to network, so I've learned from the best. Surround yourself with other women who do like things. You can't go wrong. If you're not, and this is a plug not for me, but because from my heart, if you're not in a networking organization that's professional, find one. It's really important that you have people speak for you, like word of mouth. That's what we do. We provide a word of mouth organization for you so that you have business all the time. But you have to get to know them and build the relationships. Don't think you can come in and show up and throw up and get business. That's not how it works. Show up and build relationships, and you have, what does it say? We can teach you how to fish, or we can fish for you and feed you. Yeah. Or we can teach you how to fish. I believe in letting you fish for yourself.
Very similar experience. NABO, as a young business owner, and by young I mean new, but it's great to sit around other women who share your challenges, who don't do anything like what you do for a living, yet we have the common theme of challenges. I also joined the Small Business Association here, ASBA. I joined that. I joined several and then stayed where I felt comfortable. I like to be around organizations that have both men and women. I like learning from men who are good leaders. I've learned a lot from men who are not good leaders. And I really like that. And I really recommend that you, yourself, and that you send leaders in your company who report to you to events from entirely different industries and bring back to your own industry and your own company better ideas, newer ideas. I learned the most one time. My sister works for Medtronic. Do you guys know Medtronic? They do pacemakers, they do spinal cord stimulators, and she's a sales rep for them. And I actually snuck into a meeting because they're really confidential. You have to sign all these agreements. But I snuck, she was getting an award, and I really came in through the kitchen. But I wanted to see, I was going to see this. And I watched them do one of their national meetings, and I was like, man, I've got to be there one day. But just, so just being around people who are bigger than me, better than me, more experienced than me, who don't do anything like what I do, really has benefited me greatly.
Sorry, I definitely need the question repeated again. I'm still hung up on this whole idea that women are supposed to do all the childcare work for free so that businesses can be profitable. Like, what is that? Like, it can only be profitable if women go home and do the childcare part for free. Like, I don't know. We'll have to have more of a conversation on that.
Yes.
Repeat the exact question.
I'll take a version, a slightly version of it for you, but when, you know, so what kind of support have you received that has helped you to be a success?
Definitely groups of other women. I couldn't agree more. I belong to so many different groups of women who are like-minded, and you can sit in the room and feel good. I think your question from last night about what did you want a person in the room here today to get out of the conference, and my answer back was, to be surrounded by women who are making things happen and who, you know how to get it done and who are successful, who can give you that good vibe and that good feeling. You have to see it to be it. It's so important to surround yourself with other women who are doing great things. I couldn't say enough great things about that. I mean, just get yourself into groups where women are doing stuff.
One question, and then I'll let if there's any others out there, but you all, looking at your biographies and everything that you submitted, you're involved in a few things. So me, I have two young boys, a career, travel, all that same stuff. Talk to me about time management. So are there any magic apps you use? Some way to organize your life that maybe you could share with other busy mamas out there.
I'm going to quick interrupt real quick. I'm not going to answer your question, but I'm going to tell you something funny. So, any apps that you use? So, I did a presentation with my team a year ago at our company meeting, and my staff now is younger, and I put a picture of a Rolodex up on the screen, and I said, okay, who here is under 25? And, you know, like 10 or 12 stood up, and I go, here's a $50 gift card. Any of you can tell me what that is. They go, not one person. So when Angie says you have an app, I just had to giggle.
Do you have a Franklin puppy that you use?
Sure. I have three daughters under 14, running my own company, belong to various organizations. I ran for public office in 2016. I'm probably going to run again in 2018 for something. I've decided to sit on the development review board for City of Scottsdale. We all do these things. I don't really have a secret other than, I know Robin made the comment that hats off to women who are doing it by themselves. I think my only secret is to find a really great partner. I don't have any idea how women who don't have help do it. I definitely could not do it without at least my husband being a full invested partner in my life and a babysitter full time. So I need three sets of hands to make my life work. I don't know how women do it all by themselves. I would love to hear someone explain that. I definitely get lots of help.
I was very fortunate. I was married. I loved the man. I'm not in love with him anymore, but I really love the man I'm married to now. We were married in 2005 in April, and in August of that year, I took over the presidency of the organization. I left him here with our two youngest, both in high school, and I left every morning at 6 o'clock to go to San Diego, came home every Friday night by 8. He worked all day Saturday, so I cooked and cleaned and made food for all week because I wanted them to be self-sufficient when I wasn't there, and I spent one day a week with him for 3 years. The partner is so valuable. If you don't have a man in your life, find one.
Or a
woman. It's so important that you can share. I can always complain to him. I can always uplift with him. I can just bet with him. And he's better than any organization I've ever been with. But time management is important. I'm going to tell you that I felt it was important. I belonged to everything. I sat on the ASGA board, in which you were part of a member, for 5 years. I've been on the Boys and Girls Club board. I've done a lot of things. I volunteered for a hospital when I was in California. I raised $200 million out of 240. My team raised the $200 million, and we were only responsible for $10,000 and down. The four men that were on it had to do $10 million and up. And I raised the $200 million. So I realized after a while that if I wanted my business to thrive and I wanted to be successful, I needed to step back a few paces. I've done it all, but I wasn't giving credence to my family or to myself. So tomorrow, I've been gone for a week. I went to Vail last week with my husband on vacation. I didn't take phone calls. I did do a training on live on Monday while I was there, but I didn't tell my staff because they would have been ticked. They wanted me on vacation. But tomorrow, I'm leaving my office at 2 o'clock to go to the Diamondbacks game. We're playing his team. He's a Colorado native. Just to see the ball game. Do I care? No, it's a long, drawn out thing, right? But I'm taking time to spend with my husband because it's important to him. So I want you to understand, time management is up here. It's not an app or anything else. It's what do you need for you? How do you set aside enough time for your business and yourself? And once you get that down, there's nothing you can't do. But please, please, always remember, you come first, because if something happens to you, the business doesn't go on.
One of the best pieces of advice I ever got was, only do what only you can do. Have you been told that? Only do what only you can do. If someone else can do what you're doing right now, they should. Chances are they do it better than you, but only do what only you can do. And when you think as a business owner, you know, there's only a handful of things that only I can do. I should have plenty of goddamn enough time to do stuff that I want to do and that's good for me and that grows my business, that contributes to professional development, you know, that, and to your point, that self-discipline and focusing on yourself, knowing, you know, that time management piece, taking the time to do the things that make you better is better for the people who work for you.
It is a challenging time for women right now in the world, and politically. Okay, all right. So how do you, as a business owner, do you speak your truth?
I love this question.
Yeah. Do you brand your, you know, like, Six Break and Diamond Insurance Group, do you brand separately, or do you just go? You know, use all your ovaries all the time.
I can say strongly enough that if women don't stand up and demand what we deserve, we are never going to get there. No one's going to do it for us. We couldn't get the right to vote for 50 years after black people had it in this country. Women had to fight and die and starve and go to jail for it. And we had to wait for men to give it to us. So, like, we had to actually stand up there and yell and scream and die and do all those things to get it. We can't wait for men to give us our rights, because guess what? They're not gonna. And, you know, of course, we have to convince them that, again, I'm all about equality. It's better for everyone. Equality is better for everyone. But if women ourselves don't ask for it, it's not gonna happen. So, I never mince my words. I call people out on things all the time. But, you know, again, it's about delivery. You do it in a nice way. Again, Robin called you people guys over and over and over again. That's my pet peeve. I can't stand that. I'm always aware of my language. In my business, I work with men all day long. I'm asked to sign contracts that have male language in them every day. And I push back every day. I take the contract. I cancel out everywhere it says man, and I write woman, and I send it back, and I get every day. You can't do that.
that's the template. And I'm like, change the template. When are we going to change it? It's 2017. Let's change the template. Who's going to ever say anything? No, it's just a word. No, no, you know what? Our language is our reality. We have to start changing things. And again, if you do it in a... my mother always said, you know, you can catch more flies with honey, whatever the expression is. You can do it in a way that makes people sort of, yeah, you're right. You know what? You're right. You shouldn't do that. I can't say it strongly enough. We need to speak up for ourselves and advocate for ourselves and not worry about what other people are going to say. It's never hurt my business. I think people respect you. I heard it in here earlier about authenticity. People respect you for being authentic, and they get that, and it's never hurt me. I've never lost an order because someone said, oh, you're a feminist, we're not giving you the job. Come on. Anyway, that's my two cents.
Just remember that we are damned if we do, and we're damned if we don't, right?
Right.
I'm aggressive, I'm a high D, high I, and taking those tests. So people think that I'm so aggressive that I'm a guy. Well, no, I'm just me. I say it, I speak my piece and how I feel. But remember, sometimes in business, you may not lose the order, but it depends on who you're doing business with and the culture. You need to know what you're doing and when you can say it appropriately. I do business out of the States. And so when I go into Canada, the culture is totally different. And things that I would do here in the States or say here in the States are not the same. So if you're doing business with other cultures that you're not familiar with, get to know them before you open your mouth, because you could lose business that you'll never get back. It's really easy to build bridges. It's just as easy to burn them, a little more difficult to rebuild. So I agree. I always speak my piece and who I am. That's just me. But I have to be very careful if I'm working with a culture that is not like mine.
May I rebut?
For sure.
So I've got a daughter. She actually just promoted her to be my COO. She's grown up with the company. So yay, she's fantastic. And she has her master's degree, and she's everything that I always dreamed to be, because I think we did a better job with our daughters than our parents did with us, just because of the times. So with that said, my philosophy, and again, whatever works for you guys, but my philosophy is to quietly go, quietly succeed. Do I say guys again? I'm going to say that. And so whatever works for you. I quietly go, you know what? The gentlemen around me who think that they can keep me down, I take great pride in just quietly going, I could probably buy and sell. And I'm okay with that. You know what I mean? Like, it doesn't bother me. I don't take offense at terminology. I very, very rarely. And again, a lot of it might. I can't imagine that my experience with sexism was worse than yours, being with your type of work. But in the hospital with doctors, I mean, it was physical oftentimes. Doctors groped nurses. We stood up when I first got to school. We stood up when a male doctor, because I never saw a female doctor. Never. You would have been what? One of 10, but never so. But we stood and gave them our chair, and so it was just expected that you were going to be groped and handled. But I'm quiet about it. I have fun with the whole he thinks. I just left a financial planner meeting with my husband, and it's actually my husband's financial advisor from back in the day. And every time we meet with him, I get in the car with my husband and I say, you know, if anything happened to you, he'd be gone. Just because he doesn't address me. And my husband is wonderful enough to say, she's the one that decides. Why do you keep looking at me? She's the one that decides. It's her company. She's the one that decides. And he's been, the financial planner for 20 years. But I tell my husband, oh boy, I wouldn't remember his name. But he does a good job for our money. He's done great.
No, that's great. Thank you. I feel like we could ask a million questions and keep you here probably all night. So I appreciate you all so much. So let's give one more round of applause.